Everyone to please stand as we have our invocation and pledge led by our city manager. Mr. Parrish.
Thank you, Mayor. I'd ask you to join me in prayer or silent meditation, as may be your practice. Father God, we praise your name and invite you into this city, these chambers, and into our hearts, Lord God. We thank you, Lord, for so much. Thank you for the good weather on Sunday for our air show, for protecting the pilots and the brave jumpers and all those who travel to our community for the air show. Lord God, we thank you for the recent announcement of jobs in this community. Our people like to work. Our people want to work, and we thank you for that. We thank you, Father God, as we approach elections for the freedom to vote. Lord, we lift up this nation as we prepare to vote. We're so thankful we live in a peaceful nation, unlike so many others, where we can agree to disagree and take our differences to the ballot box. Be with our leaders, Lord, at every level. Give them wisdom, judgment, and compassion. And Father God, we both thank you for and lift up our police and fire officers who protect us and keep us safe. Lord, I pray your hand of protection upon them. Bless Owensboro, Father, and keep us safe and productive. In Christ's name I pray, Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Now the pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, with that, commissioners, tonight we're going to pass on recognizing the Vietnam veterans. Pam, Commissioner Smith Wright heads that up, and she's not here, and I don't believe we've got any veterans with us tonight. With that, we will go to a presentation by of our triplet twist by Ms. Shelton.
Mayor and commissioners, thank you very much for the opportunity to give you an update on the triplet twist district project going on. Currently, we have these programs through the implementation phases, some this year, some next year. Neighborhood identity, commercial facade, rehab, beautification, housing, and safety. And I'll review each of these in a little bit of detail and give you an idea of what we're currently doing in these areas. As you know, we have $128,000 in public funds set aside for the neighborhood identity entryway projects. 26 sites have been picked out. The top picture that you see is the before, the bottom picture is after, and that's just an idea that Keith Free had come up with as far as what our options could be with these key entry sites. These also include landscaping, signage, beautification, and tree plantings. The landscaping and beautification is a little bit more extensive throughout the project. $214,000 and $375 in public funds, $18,000 and $375 in private funds. Estimated 180 trees, 32 sites, and both neighborhood and commercial enhancements and landscaping for a total of $232,750. So, my staff, myself, has contracted with Bacon Farmer and Workman to come up with a comprehensive plan for key entry sites throughout the Triplet Twist District. So it's kind of a two-phase project because I wanted to get an idea of incorporating both public safety, which we'll talk about later, features as far as sidewalks, entryways, and maximizing our dollar, our public dollar within the Triplet Twist District and coming up with a comprehensive plan. Also to include maybe some public facilities improvements and working with engineering and public works to maybe take care of some of those projects. So that design will hopefully be done and implemented in early spring next year throughout the warmer months so we can have a blitz, as you would say, throughout that area. Also, we do have a partnership with Bimbo Bakeries, and on October 7th, they are going to get their staff out there to plant up to $5,000 in that median right north of Jay's Liquors, and it's a pretty prominent median, and it's got a lot of traffic on it. So, excuse me. On the right hand side is just a mock-up of what they are going to put into the median, and I believe that if you drive by it currently, we have it being leveled out, and thanks to Public Works for partnering with that. But yeah, October 17th at about 9 o'clock, if you guys want to go out there, you'll see there people out there doing some good work, and of course that's donated by them. Commercial facade upgrades, we have an estimated $429,600 in public funds, $286,400 in private, 34 sites, including building enhancements, new signs, parking improvements, basically taking the facades of those businesses along the corridor and giving them a facelift, $716,000 in total. Currently, we have two businesses that have taken advantage of and five more in the pipeline, working with those business owners to get the right contractors for their needs. Bella Vita Salon has relocated from Williamsburg Square to 1308 Triplet, and they took advantage of a little bit of money with their signage. So you can see on the left, of course, before and on the right after, and there's a lot more traffic in that area. So I look for her to take advantage of more of that grant as she progresses in her business. 1601 Jerry Miller Boulevard, it's a New Day LLC finance business. It will be complete facade redo. I don't have a mock-up because it changed as we got the contractor on board, and Mr. Hurl Goodwin owns that corner, and it'll be a gray building with a black detail on the top, and those are old bay doors, so you'll see all that the iron come off of the building and the windows being redone and landscaping, new fence, and so it'll be a nice facelift. And across from that business, there's the Imperial Landscaping, and they just put up a new building, and they're going to redo, OMPC is having them redo their fence, so that'll be a really nice enhancement to that corner. It'll couple well together. As far as housing, we have $772,000 in public and $2.7 in private investment set aside for home buyer, build, rehab, home buyer down payment, and existing homeowner repair for a total of $3.5 million. And we are in the programs of down payment assistance and existing homeowner repair. We only have had one person take advantage of the down payment assistance up to $5,000, closing costs or down payment assistance. And it's been a nice opportunity for me to reach out to the banking industry in this community and partner with them and get some product that they can fine tune for the clientele in this area, because you know, it's easy to attract commercial parts of the banking industry, but to actually reach out with a low interest loan that people can take advantage of and match with the existing homeowner repair, that's been a great accomplishment. We do have a new build at 1020 East 20th Street, which we are paying for. That is the lot on the left-hand side with the trees on and the house. The house is currently gone, and I think in the next few days the trees will be taken down as well. So you'll see the house on the right, that skeleton will be put up in the next few months. And like I said, existing homeowner rehab grants, we have currently 12 homes that are going to participate in the phase one, and that means I have all the projects that they would like to do, all the income information I need from them, and then we'll go into all the other paperwork and the good HUD paperwork that we have to go through to make sure they get what they need. So that'll be anywhere from siding to roofing, landscaping if it fits, fencing, and making those much needed updates to those residents. Public safety, $121,000 has been set aside for new sidewalks and a new transit facility. And you know, it's kind of $121,000 plus because we don't know obviously as of yet what that will entail. But hopefully with the new plan that we're doing with the consultant, that'll take into account what's going to happen in that neighborhood as far as walkability and livability for reaching if we do construct a new facility. Gabe's Tower obviously is a hot button topic, and it is a linchpin for this development. And that's just a little bit of a background. May 2013, the current owners purchased the property. September 2015, work began and was halted due to the presence of asbestos. November 2015, Gabe's was gutted and citations were issued. In May 2015, work was completed on that, and in June, the current owners made the announcement of the Best Western Premier Hotel relocating there, and in September we issued the deadline for action. So with that site, we have a public reuse proposed for a new transit hub, and including acquisition and demolition of that the building that is currently on that property at 1926 Triplet Street. It's a central location. It would be easily accessible because of the sidewalks and the old infrastructure that exists. So it's a larger facility. It would be a larger facility and less dangerous for pedestrians and passengers to get off. And, you know, it's at 5th and 5th Street downtown now. So it's not a very user-friendly location. So the total plan, again, is $4.7 million, and we are just at the beginning stages of that, but we're well on our way and have gotten a lot of interest in all the programs, so we're pushing forward. Yes, sir.
Abby, back up. I'm going to go back to a couple of these things to ask questions.
Sure.
Right there. Stop there for a minute. In regards to that new transit hub, if that were to happen, and maybe this is a question for you, Bill. I know originally when we were talking with these developers, we were going to acquire some property.
That's correct.
And do some demolition. Is that still in the works? Is that still in the plan?
We're going to acquire a piece of property, we believe, with this also, Mayor, which is located just to the east of that property. It's 0.359 acres. Ed, can you put this on the Elmo or?
Here, Ed.
Okay. It's currently a, if you go there, it's owned by the pawn shop. It's got concertina wire and vehicles parked behind it.
And so we are looking to acquire that as a part of the transit?
That's correct.
Hub. Okay. All right. Show me that.
So that 0.359, the 0.88 acres is what's already part of the Gabe's Tower property. We would also recommend pursuing immediately to the east, there bordering Triplett Street, the 0.359 acres you see in green.
Right. Okay. Okay. We're good. All right. Let's, and I don't think I need the overheads for this. Abby, the facade improvements for the businesses, are those loans or are those grants?
Those are grants. It's a 50-50 matching grant, and all the money is paid up front by the business owner. We contract with the contractor, sign an agreement, and that work is completed through the City of Owensboro.
Very good. And the public money we're referring to, that's all federal money?
It's all federal money, yes.
Okay, I want to make sure everybody understands that.
Yes,
that's
sir.
Not local tax dollars.
Not general
dollars,
fund, yes.
That's federal HUD money. Okay. I'll only make one comment, and then I'll open it up to the commission, but... Abby, well done on this project. You're
Thank
doing
you.
A great job with this. You know, we have talked many times about how we want to not only focus our attention on our downtown, and it does get a lot of attention, but we are working throughout this community, and this is a good example of it. This Triplett Twist area is going to be, it's my understanding, the largest redevelopment project that we have done to date. We have done Mechanicsville, Germantown, Baptist Town, all of these, but this will be the largest one. And I think this is a very exciting project. It's a very needed project, and it's a very timely project because I think we're getting in there at the right time. Because if we don't continue to invest, commissioners, and I think everybody up here knows that, into the core of this city, you know, things can go south pretty quickly. And I think this influx of these dollars is going to be a great asset to the city because, you know, if we maintain property and things grow and develop, and it seems like that once you start to improve things, people take more interest and things, additional things happen, and the downtown's a perfect example of that. So I think this is an exciting project, and we're going to talk a little bit more about Gabe's and this idea of moving this transit center out there, which I think is an excellent idea. It just doesn't fit downtown. It's too small, too many large buses or whatever, but that's for here further on our agenda. Abby, the only thing, the other question I've got is, what is the timeline here? You know, I know Mechanicsville took a while, and so did some of these others. What are we looking at here in terms of time?
I hope to have every project completed, the money expended for this NRSA, by 2019, June 2019.
2019. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Good. That's great. All right. Commissioners, anybody got any questions? Commissioner Glenn.
First question I have, Abby, is, and maybe Bill can help with this. There are a couple other properties on the schematic, the Chase Bank building and then the 0.14 acres. So we don't have any interest at all in those properties.
At this point, all we're asking for is the 0.88, which is the Gabe's property, and the 0.359, which is the adjacent property.
Okay, and what? Let's presume all this happens, and we shift our transit center to where the tower currently is. What will happen with the current transit center? Do we have any plans for that property?
It'll be sold. We would recommend just being sold. The city would no longer have use. I would also point out, since you're along this line, if I may, Mayor, that currently there are 8 transit routes, excluding the downtown trolley. We think that we can either reduce to 7 transit routes because of the central location, or when Highway 54 and all that building occurs, that we would not have to add an additional transit route. So somewhere between 1 and 2 transit route savings by going this route.
That's great.
No pun intended.
I've got 2 other quick questions. You've got this qualifying program, the down payment assistance program.
Yes, sir.
So do we still have opportunities to encourage other possible home buyers to do that, or is that opportunity, that window
shut?
Oh,
yes. Every program is still open. Like I said, I've only had 1 participant. I do check the Owensboro MLS and drive through regularly and just make random phone calls to the real estate people in that area. But I do have a good relationship with not only a mortgage banker that's got his feelers into that area, but also making new friends with realtors. So it's a good partnership over there as well. So yes, encourage anybody and everybody to call me, first-time home buyer, income-based eligible.
Sounds like a great program. Last question. I know we have a big agenda. The MPD building near Germantown Park that was going to be converted into apartments, where are we at this stage?
We are working through a land issue as of right now, clearing that up, and then hopefully we can see movement in December of this year. So,
great. Well, Abby, thank you for all you're doing to
thank
transform
you.
That portion of our city.
Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner. Anyone else? Commissioner?
I do think this is a perfect solution for the transit system. It is right in the heart of Owensboro with the growth out on 54. This has really become the center of our community. And the fact that we have the Macaulay Clinic just north of this location, located in the old hospital facility. It's been upgraded, and so that's become a very busy place. So this will be a real benefit for those folks who are trying to get over to that clinic.
Mayor Pro Tem.
Yes. Abby, if you have an existing house that wants, and someone wants to upgrade it, they do qualify for?
Everybody qualifies.
So everything that I see pretty much on this map. So.
No, it extends from 9th Street
okay.
to 24th Street,
okay.
from Breckenridge to Triplett Street, including Colonial Court and other areas outside of Colonial Court, small areas. It is income-based. It's a sliding scale. So depending upon where you fit into the income, HUD income levels,
right.
we'll pay so much of a percentage. So it'd be 80-20 or 70-30.
Right.
So you can get us to pay up to 90% of the improvements on your home.
Right.
And we are working with banks, like I said, local banks, to give people an option if they don't have that cash up front to facilitate that,
right.
that need.
So basically, if someone wants to put new siding, a new door, landscape, they can do all those things, and they have
many
choices to go through if they
yes.
want to do that.
Yeah, and we take care of all the legwork as far as contractors, hiring those people, making sure the homeowners are mm-hmm. comfortable with them, and of course they have to meet our purchasing guidelines, so it's not just going to be somebody from off the street
okay.
coming
well,
in.
What's your feedback on existing homeowners? Is anybody participating yet, or are they waiting to see other things happen? Or
well, like I said, we have 12 in the pipeline. Uh-huh. I did send out with the help of GIS and postcards advertising mm-hmm. that we have mm-hmm. the program going on. I have at least 4 phone calls a day
okay.
now consistently for the past week.
That's
so
good.
as okay. projects, and then there's quite a few in Colonial Court, so as projects come to fruition, I would expect more participation.
Right. Okay. Back through here. Okay. Thank you very much.
Yeah.
Yes, go ahead.
Abby, do you have templates in place or something, some guidelines to keep everything relatively consistent in that area so that it's just not a hodgepodge of newness?
As far as locations as to where the projects are going to happen, or are you talking about
the upgrades, the decor, you know, the facades homes or
yes,
the things
yes,
that you're
there,
doing?
There is a certain standard that HUD, of course, requires, and that, of course, we've set the standard with. So within the budget of the homeowner, it's going to be a process to work with, but to make sure everybody to make
there's
it look,
some sort of consistency
yeah, oh yeah,
of the
yeah.
style of the yeah. properties and that sort of
and,
thing.
And luckily enough, in that area, most of the homes are pretty much, you know, they have the same kind of style, same kind of feel. They're all probably built in the 1940s, mm-hmm. 50s, so mm-hmm. it's easy to match up and say, okay, well, this person's done this, so do you want to use this siding or this roof? And usually people can go around and point out and say, yeah, I'd like that house. So as we get more people on board, I'll give it examples. This is the siding that somebody's picked out, and this is how much it costs, so most definitely.
Anyone else? Abby, thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Commissioners, the next item on our agenda is to consider approval of the minutes of our meeting dated September 20th, 2016. Do I have a motion for approval?
Motion.
Second.
Second. Any questions, comments, corrections? Anyone? Call for the vote.
Commissioner Glenn?
Yes.
Commissioner Nunley?
Yes.
Mayor Payne?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Sanford?
Yes.
Motion passes. Commissioners, the next item is board appointments. We only have one board tonight that we're appointing individuals to. It's the Human Relations Commission. Appoint J.D. Warfield and Caitlin Donweiler to a one-year term expiring October 4th, 2017. Do I have a motion for approval?
Motion.
Second.
Any questions, comments? Call for the vote.
Commissioner Nunley?
Yes.
Mayor Payne?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Sanford?
Yes.
Commissioner Glenn?
Yes.
Very good. Motion passes. Commissioners, we'll now go to our ordinances. We have for second reading. We will vote on these. The first one, Counselor.
Thank you, Mayor. Commissioners, Ordinance 20-2016, an ordinance amending the annual budget for the fiscal year beginning July 1st, 2016 and ending June 30th, 2017. And amending Ordinance 13-2016 to provide funding for property acquisition for downtown economic development and to complete the carryovers from prior year. Publicly read for approval on second reading this fourth day of October 2016.
Do I have a motion for approval?
Motion.
Second.
Second. Mr. Parrish, I know we've walked through this before, but given the fact that we're going to be dealing with this property acquisition, let's go to 1717, that economic development fund, because I got one question. We show a fund balance, it looks like $1.5 million, it's going down to close this alley. So with that, I'll ask, is any comments, questions by the commission, the public? Call for the vote.
Mayor Pro Tem Sanford?
Yes.
Commissioner Glenn?
Yes.
Commissioner Nunley?
Yes.
Mayor Payne?
Yes. Next item, Counselor.
Ordinance 22-2016, an ordinance levying ad valorem taxes for municipal purposes for the fiscal year commencing July 1st, 2016 and ending June 30th, 2017 at the rate of 26.31 cents per $100 of assessed valuation of real property, 26.61 cents per $100 of assessed valuation of personal property, and 30.30 cents per $100 of assessed valuation of vehicles, and providing for the collection and apportionment of same. Publicly read for approval on second reading this fourth day of October 2016.
Now, let me ask something here. This, it looks like we got both of these ordinances on here. Is that correct? This one increases the property tax, the next one does not. So I'll ask, is there a motion to do this? No motion. Very good. Dies for a lack of a motion. Go ahead, Mr. Ray.
Mayor, just as a point of order, I would make a recommendation that there be a motion to permanently table this particular ordinance. That would clear up the record, and you could move on to the second ordinance.
Table it, or do we want to vote it down?
You can do either, has the same effect. So rather than letting it die
for lack of a motion
and second.
All right, I'll again ask if there's a motion to approve this.
There's a motion.
Second?
Second.
Okay, that will be for the purposes of voting on this. Again, we've talked about this previously, that I, for one, don't want to increase our property taxes. I've stated clearly why I do not want to do this. So are there any other comments? I think we've all made our position clear. Anybody from the public? If not, call for the vote.
That's on the personal property.
Very good. Any comments from anyone on the commission? Anyone of the public? Call for the vote.
Commissioner Nunley?
Yes.
Mayor Payne?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Sanford?
Yes.
Commissioner Glenn?
Yes.
Motion passes. Next item we'll have, commissioners, is our ordinances for first reading. We don't vote on them tonight, but we can discuss. Counselor?
Ordinance 24-2016, an ordinance authorizing the retention of up to 1% of all new occupational license fees due and payable to the City of Owensboro, Kentucky by ordinance from the salaries, wages, and other compensation to be paid to new employees of Specialty Food Groups Incorporated, provided said corporation meets the criteria set forth in its application for incentives under the Kentucky Business Investment Program, introduced and publicly read on first reading this fourth day of October 2016.
All right, Bill, we got somebody that was going to explain
Mayor,
this.
I can start this.
You're going to do that? Go ahead.
Mayor, SFG is located partially in the city. Part of their building is in the county. Through city and county cooperation, SFG is adding 95 jobs using a state incentive matched 3-1 by the state, 1 by the city. For that, for each city job, the city will invest 1% of the occupational, rebate that to SFG, for a period of 10 years. We would still gain 0.06 in the general fund and 0.33 in your community vision. Joe Berry is here for any other details. Mayor.
Thank you. Commissioners, glad to be with you this evening.
Go ahead, Joe.
Wanted to just give a little bit of background. This is actually a project that came about in October of 2014. As you all know, with the incentive process, a company goes before the Kentucky Economic Development Finance Authority, and they approve the incentives as a but-for clause. Then the company activates those incentives when they're ready to start hiring. And tonight, we're about finalizing that incentive package. So those jobs have been created. SFG is hiring, so we're very grateful for their continued investment in this community. They have a capped amount that was granted to them, about $2,250,000. This is based on a $6 million expansion. $3.2 million of those were eligible under this program. And yes, it was a growth of 95 net new jobs. We did check with SFG, and I believe Jenna Mitchell from SFG is with us this evening. And their current, as of August, their employee count here in Owensboro is 571 employees. The average wage of these new jobs is $24 an hour, including benefits.
That's what I was going to ask. $24 an hour?
Yes, sir.
Very good. Anything else, Joe?
Well, I just let the commission know that because this falls in both the city and the county, that the county will be approving a similar ordinance at their next meeting.
Great. Okay. Well, with the 850, I think we announced it in Lorca. Now we got 95, and we'll keep our fingers crossed by having an additional 200. So that's quite a few jobs here in the last few months. Joe, thank you so
thank
much
you,
for what
thank
you do at Economic Development
thank
Corporation.
You.
This is for 10 years, though there is a ceiling on how much money they can recover, so it may not go 10 years.
Correct.
Is that correct? Yeah, that's my understanding. Okay. Any questions by the commission? More good news.
I just had a quick question, Joe. Don't feel they've moved their headquarters here, have they not?
That's correct.
I mean, I want people to know that. They moved their headquarters here.
They have moved
here.
Their corporate headquarters here. Company that, going back to their early days as field packing, had a long tradition of being valuable corporate citizens here in Owensboro. We're very But yes, it's very exciting that they were able to locate their headquarters here in Owensboro.
Yeah, I wanted that in the record. So very good. Thank you, sir.
Thank you all.
Thank you. Any questions from the public about this? Anyone? Councilor, next item.
Ordinance 25-2016, a supplemental ordinance providing for the authorization and issuance of electric light and power system revenue bonds in one or more series in the aggregate principal amount of not to exceed $50 million of the City of Owensboro, Kentucky, for the purpose of refunding certain outstanding revenue bonds of said city, authorizing the sale of said bonds to the purchaser thereof identified herein, providing for the security and payment of said bonds and interest thereon from the available income and revenues of the municipal electric light and power system of said city, and providing for certain other matters in connection therewith. Introduced and publicly read on first reading this fourth day of October 2016.
Very good. All right, Lynn, you going to
yes, sir.
Walk us through this.
I am.
Very good.
Good afternoon. Lynn Holland, Director of Finance and Accounting with Owensboro Municipal Utilities. We are refunding all of the 2010 C bonds and a partial advance refunding for the 2013 B bonds. These are tax-exempt bonds we'd like to refinance. The original interest rates were 3% and 4%, or close to 4%. We'd like to refinance at 1.8 or less, depending on what the sale date of October 26 brings us. We're projecting savings of approximately $3.1 million. We have the 2010 C bonds is approximately $8.9 million we're refunding, and the 2013 B bonds is approximately $35 million we're asking to refund. This is just a sample of our existing outstanding par bonds, the original issuance. This is what the chart looks like before and after the refunding. The purple will be the refinanced bonds. The bonds that are defeased or paid off will be sent over to off the OMU books, and they're set up in escrow to be paid out to the bondholders. So our current amount of principal will stay about the same, and our term for the bonds will be the same. We'll still have all the debt paid off in 2027. Our considerations, because these are tax-exempt bonds, we're only proposing to refinance the tax exempt portion of our outstanding bonds. The taxable bonds, we can't have any savings at this time. There's negative arbitrage interest savings on those. If we do refinance these bonds, our next call date is 2020, and therefore, if we were to have need a refinancing between now and the fiscal year 2020, they would have to be reissued as taxable bonds, which, depending on what the rates are at that time, it could go up or down. But that is a consideration. We believe at this time that it's in our best interest to grab the $3 million of savings. We expect potentially to offer or issue $19.2 million of bonds about this time next year for fiscal 18. That will be for a potential citywide build out on fiber to the home project. We've got that built in our next 5-year forecast. The other item to consider is if we do need to refinance our current bonds, anything outstanding, we can go up to 120% of the weighted life of those bonds. So for the distribution system, we could go out to 2054 if we need to extend our debt. Currently, it all ends in 2027. This is our timeline. Can't really read that, it's so small. We've just had our rating presentations yesterday and today to Moody's and Standard & Poor's. We'll receive our rating updates next week. We expect for our current rating of A rating to be affirmed or maybe better. We expect the city, we request city approval on the 18th at the city commission meeting. Our pricing will be on October 26th, and then we will close the bonds the end of November. And that's all I have. Do you have any questions?
I've got one, if that's okay.
Go ahead, Mayor. Commissioner.
So you're saying that on, it looks like the 26th, you're going to have a discussion with your rate the people that establish your credit rating and that you expect it to go up? Did I
on October 13th.
October 13th, okay.
We don't expect it to go down. We expect it to be affirmed or could be higher.
Okay. Right. Well, that's good news. Let me ask one more while we're all sitting here looking. So what is your revenue stream? Going back to the fiber optic, the home fiber optic, what's the revenue stream to pay the bonds back?
We've built a integrated resource model to model out 10, 15 years of what our revenues will look like on the electric system, which includes the telecom build out. And it will, in 2022, we will be cash flow positive after we issue the bonds. And we're issuing the bonds potentially with a 3-year capitalized interest to get us to that point.
Thank you.
Lynn, back up. Now, how much are we refunding here?
$42 million approximately.
$42 million. Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah. $42 million.
Not to exceed $50 million.
Gotcha. Okay. And you're saying we're defeasing the old bonds, mm-hmm. So we're not calling them in. We're just
sending them to escrow.
Sending them to escrow. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Right. Okay.
But they come off our books.
Very good. So this is first reading. We don't vote on it. We'll vote on it our next meeting and on the 18th. Mm-hmm. Okay. Any questions, other questions by the commission? Anyone with the public? So basically what we're doing here is
just a straight
we're saving
refinancing.
Some money, $3 million.
Right. Right.
Okay.
No new projects.
Very good. All right. Any questions, comments from the public? Let's move on to the next item, Counselor. Municipal orders.
Municipal Order 26-2016, a municipal order authorizing the mayor to execute a parking lot lease agreement between the City of Owensboro and OWB Downtown LLC, whereby the city shall lease to OWB Downtown LLC 114 parking spaces at the lot located on or about 424 West 2nd Street, 414 West 2nd Street, and 215 Locust Street, and further provide alternative parking during the construction of a new downtown parking garage. Introduced to publicly read for approval this fourth day of October 2016.
All right, municipal order, we do vote on this tonight. Do I hear a motion for approval?
Motion.
Second.
Second. Mr. Parrish, you or Mr. Ray?
Mr. Ray is going to cover all your municipal orders.
Counselor?
Thank you, Mayor, Commissioners. Alorica needed 375 parking spaces downtown. When you put the numbers together with their announcement of over 800 jobs, we got to realize that they are working shift work. So there'll be a presence downtown, which is a fantastic thing for our retailers and everybody else, from early morning until late into the evening, typically 6 days a week. But 375 is the number of parking spaces they needed. Those parking spaces included various different lots, including the BB&T building, and also 114 parking spaces owned by the City of Owensboro at the former Shakers lot. Shakers BB&T, it's the lot that's been paved across from the convention center immediately west of the Gritz garage on that same block. This 114 parking spaces is part of an incentive for Lorica to come in. The developer is the one that's leasing these parking spaces. That enabled Alorica to get a lease rate that they were satisfied with by not having to additionally pay for parking. So during the construction of a parking garage, provided that throughout the next several months we get to that point, then those spaces will have to be relocated temporarily. And this also provides a method for those parking spaces to be temporarily relocated at a place downtown, or both the developer, Alorica, and the City of Owensboro can work together to make that happen. So it's a great small piece that the city can play in the overall job creation, but I would add to that over the course of 20 years, which is the lifetime of the TIF, with these jobs in Owensboro, we have over a $4 billion economic impact to the City of Owensboro from Alorica's presence in Owensboro alone. So
say that again, Ed.
That's over $4
billion. $4 billion.
So it's a significant economic tool for Owensboro, and it's a small piece of that the City of Owensboro is doing to make this happen. Subject to any questions, that's all I have.
Any questions? Pretty self-explanatory. Anybody? Anybody from the public? Ed, thank you very much.
Sir.
Call for the vote.
Mayor Payne?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Sanford?
Yes.
Commissioner Glenn?
Yes.
Commissioner Nunley?
Yes.
Motion passes. Next item, Counselor.
Municipal Order 27-2016, a municipal order authorizing institution of proceedings under the Eminent Domain Act of Kentucky against Trevor Foraker, Richard Killian, and Kenneth L. Bellow Sr. for property located at 1926 Triplett Street for use by the City Transit Department. Introduced and publicly read for approval this fourth day of October 2016.
Do I have a motion for approval?
Motion.
Second.
Second. Mr. Parrish or Mr. Ray? This just begins the process. Is that correct? We go into negotiations. At this point in time, we're not actually condemning the building. Is that walk me through this?
Yes,
legally.
Sir. You're absolutely right. What this does is two things. One is it gives direction to the mayor through his staff to continue to negotiate for the purchase of the property. There has been a staff-initiated initial offer of purchase to the property. The offer has expired, and they did not take up the city's offer on that. Therefore, we move forward with this. That doesn't stop the staff on the behalf of this commission, you mayor, from continuing to negotiate a settled price. But what it does do is it allows for us to initiate and file the petition for eminent domain and condemnation of that property, and which is a significant step forward in allowing us to negotiate and move this forward with the type of speed that we believe the commission has desired. So we will come back with updates as meetings progress, and if ultimately we reach a settlement as far as a price, then we will come back for official authority for the mayor and commission for you to approve that in a budget amendment.
Very good. Thank you, Ed. I'll only add one more thing to the comments I've already made about this, because I think this transit office, new transit office in that location is a wonderful idea. You know, we're trying to revitalize that portion of our city. We need to do that. I feel like we have really, really been patient here with these developers. And I also feel like if they were sincere with moving forward, and I don't know whether they are or not, but I just felt that, you know, an act of good faith would have been to give us that performance bond so that we had some sense that this was going to happen. But I've got to tell you is I move around this city. All I hear is, Mayor, when are y'all going to take down that Gabe's Tire? I've heard no one tell me they think that we ought to maintain or keep that facility. So it's time to do something here. And, you know, I feel like this is the right step for us to do in moving forward. And it's in the best interest of our city. So with that, I'll ask the commission if anyone else has any comments in regards to this.
Just another. I think we've been very fair to these developers, but we've not really been fair to the citizens of Owensboro. And I, too, hear complaints frequently, more than any other thing, about the Gabe's Tower. It is a source of embarrassment. We're a proud community, and when people come through and see this dilapidated building, and we're still allowing it to stay there year after year after year, I just think it's an embarrassment if we don't do something right away. So.
Yeah, it's also, as the mayor's pointed out, in the center core of our city, and it's hard if you take industrial prospects or prospects for the hospital to avoid driving through that area. It's a heavy traffic area, and the people that live in that neighborhood have talked to me for years about it, and I'm very much gratified that we're going to take this step today to make the beginning stages of moving forward, not only for that, the Triplett Twist development as well, because it goes hand in hand with that. So I think this is a positive step.
Anyone else?
Yeah, just
thank you.
Just to agree with my colleagues up here, I've been all over the city in the last couple months, and I have talked to tons of people, and they all want the tower down, basically. I haven't heard one person say, keep it up, do something else with it. I have to agree totally that people are ready for it to come down.
Any other questions, comments up here? Anyone in the public? Yes, sir.
My name is James Gillespie. I live at 3008 Davis Street here in Owensboro. I was born and raised here. I do object to taking down Gabe's Tower. I feel like it is it's an icon for this area. And I don't know who you're talking to, Mayor, but most of the people I talk to, yes, it is an eyesore, but it is also an icon for this area. It took $1.5 million to build that building. Can you imagine how much it would cost today to build that, rebuild that building, just the steel and the concrete in it alone? I mean, a lot of money. So for us to just sit here and, hey, let's put a transit center there, which you can also, like he was talking about, you could put it right next to where the Chase Bank is sitting there vacant. You know, not that it's not a bad idea, but it's a bad idea to take out an icon, because a lot of this area wouldn't have existed if it wasn't for Gabe himself that built that tower. You know, so we need to, it's also eligible for a historical site. If the city would move in that direction of making it a historical site, then you can apply for grants to make that building a valuable part of that area. You know, everybody's got their head wrapped around, the only thing it could be is a hotel. Well, that's not true. You can, there's so much uses for that building that you can do. And I know me personally, with all my memories, I can remember all the wedding receptions and parties I went to. I did wedding receptions up there. If you had ever been to the top of that building, most of the people would tell you it's a beautiful sight up there. And it's also, there's not many areas in Owensboro that you can go that high and see all over Owensboro. And, you know, I think this company that bought this property saw that in this building. I don't know why they stopped what they were doing, but I feel like that if a company like that was going to invest in that, then we can get some other company to come in here and actually invest some money into our community. You know, I think it is a really valuable, it could turn into something. It's just like the buildings downtown. If we decided, hey, you know, a lot of them were in bad shape, and everybody up here can admit they were in really bad shape downtown, but y'all saw the vision of making it look a lot better. And look at downtown now. Look at all them buildings that were saved. You know, we're talking about a part of our history, and that's what Gabe's Tower is. It's a part of our history. Yes, it's an eyesore, but look at all the buildings across the country that have been saved and redone, and like before and after pictures. And you think, oh my gosh, you know, there was a building that was done like that in French Lick, and now it's everybody talks about it now. You know, there's so much more that you can do with that tower and just a hotel.
Very good.
And I would ask the commission, the city commission, to, hey, let's explore all the options before we say, hey, let's take down an icon. You know.
Thank you, sir.
All right.
Anyone else? Yes, sir.
Bob Zimmerman, Owensboro. I'm confused on the condemnation proceedings. Initially, or months or years ago, it started out, the talk started out, I guess, with a condemnation with the intention of removing the building because it was unsafe or unsuitable for human habitation. But now, just recently, it's a total taking of the property. For eminent domain, is that right?
Oh, yes, the question. This is the first step towards condemnation. We've never done it before. This is the initial step to move forward with condemnation.
Right.
Up to this point in time, the city's been working with the developer.
There's been a lot of talk. I know you said months ago, said it's got to go. Your quote was it's got to go. So I'm just curious, Ned may be able to help us with that. How I guess what I'm trying to say is if it's through the condemnation process, it seems like it, in the newspaper, it seems like it's a done deal almost, but the owners would still have a right of appeal, not if it's eminent domain, I don't think. I don't know. I'm no attorney, but if it's I had a historical home here in Owensboro that was condemned by the city about 7 years ago, and the condemnation notice said that I had 10 days to come down and get a demolition permit, or two remedies: get a demolition permit or appeal the city's decision on demolishing it. And of course I bought the house. It was in terrible shape. Nobody had a problem with it. The neighbors, the city, nobody had a problem. For 20 years, is this beautiful home as it is today deteriorated?
So what's your question? You want to know about what the process is?
Will the owners, and I have no interest in it financially or otherwise, other than I kind of agree with the gentleman, if they just been given the opportunity, they're making progress on it. Is that correct?
No.
Some.
No.
Oh, they're not?
Well, they've got it all one floor.
Well, I'm still trying to figure out, have you got a question that you're asking us, or do you just want to comment? I'm trying to help here.
I've got a question on what is a city, what type of condemnation, if it comes to that, if they're issued a condemnation order.
Let me have Ed, our city attorney, explain the process.
Sure. And Mayor, I think I could clarify this. There are two processes that sometimes get overlapped from a terminology perspective, and I think Mr. Zimmerman points out a really good point. There are places within Owensboro that we condemn. We condemn those for the purposes of occupancy. And sometimes it's confused utilizing the authority of condemnation versus when we condemn a property that's not suitable or is dilapidated in the community. The process Mr. Zimmerman's referring to is our property maintenance code enforcement people that go out and they post that this home is condemned and cannot be occupied. What we're talking about here is, and by the way, Gabe's Tower was condemned years ago, and that condemnation order has never been lifted and it remains in effect today. What we're talking about here, as you're well aware of, is condemnation via the power of eminent domain, which is a complete ownership transfer of the property. And so hopefully that explains the difference, what Mr. Zimmerman was referring to, and helps explain a little bit more to the public what process we're going through.
Very good.
I appreciate
all right.
that.
Anyone else?
That's what I was trying.
Thank you, sir. I think, real quick, because go ahead.
His conversation brought up another question. That you said that there was, I believe you said that there was a condemnation order issued against that property years ago.
That's what he said. Yes.
I recently got a open records request for that address, 1926 Triplett Street, and I didn't see, I mean, I'm not saying it wasn't, but I'm just curious why it wasn't in those open records requests. Unless Mr. Lynn told me, sent me a letter the other day saying he would no longer honor or act on open records requests from me, and I don't know that he can do that, but he...
Sir, you need to address your questions up here to the commission. This is not a place to have an open forum, so, I need to know what your question is.
My question is there an existing condemnation order against 1926 Triplett Street?
I think our city attorney just said there was.
That's okay. Correct, Mayor. And the remembering in open records request, what that is a request for any written documentation that is currently in the file. It doesn't require the city custodian to create a document and the condemnation order is in effect. It's in our system. However, there's not a document that's in the file, paper document or anything else that would show, like, for instance, a copy of what was posted there years and years ago. And as far as the, just for clarification, the issue of going to Leland Hancock, our Deputy Director of Public Works, the open records requests are always to go to the custodian of records. The issue really is that they need to be sent to our city clerk, who will then make sure that the proper custodian gets them versus sending them to individual staff people. So we will always respond to open records requests.
Very good.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
One other thing.
Anyone else? No, sir. I think your time is up. You've used your time. Anyone else?
Time on it.
Yes.
The gentleman
anyone else?
Over here was talking.
Yeah.
Pro-gage.
I think it's about the same. Sorry.
Okay.
Anyone else? Yes, sir. Come forward. No, you sit down.
My name is Stephen Wallen. I just came up here to say that I believe this is another big mistake the city's doing.
Mr. Wallen, welcome back. We haven't seen you in a while. It's good to see you, sir.
I've missed being up here with a government that I have not a lot of respect for, and I believe that has not been doing honorable things for quite a while, and especially with this building that y'all are going after and these two owners, this building, what I understand and you understand, there's only five buildings in the whole world that are made like this. You are going after these people the way you went after my mother's property, the way you went after over 8, according to what I believe and what I understand, over 8,000 to 10,000 other homeowners, run them out of their homes, took their homes, and bought many of them unnecessarily. Y'all got debts. You have no business being into buying people's properties, and you pushed entirely too many people out of their homes, homeless people that the God only knows where all of them are at, and our community's getting poor. Mayor, this is a rare building that y'all are looking at. Commissioners, y'all ought to be ashamed of yourself of being so much on the Johnny on the spot that you want to do away. They won't never build another building like that here in this city. And any business building, any businessman that ever heard what you're doing to these business people that own that building, if they have anything, just because you want to expand your government or maybe make the property available, as I believe you have in the past, for political friends and cronies of this government, I think it's wrong. I think it is absolutely out in outer space what you're doing. And you're also violating and making us all poor. That building is worth many millions. It's a sound building. Just as many of the thousands that you and your government have promoted to tear down and run these people out. Our community is on the edge of a bankruptcy. The government is. This is a declining community. Downtown is not paid for. It won't be paid for. And getting ready for reversals with this government, you know it. And everybody up here, and y'all are trying to fool many, many people in this community and other people that come along to this community. You're wrong. These poor people, these two businessmen that y'all are going to try to rip off, and they'll lose everything. I think also it was outrageous to want to get a 150,000 dollar bond issue, and all you was going to do is get the money for a bond performance thing. Then you was going to eventually condemn the property, take it anyway.
Wrap it up, Mr. Borland. This is dictatorship,
and this is wrong. I don't agree with it. I know most of the community are outraged by this. They're a silent majority, and I want you to know this government is one of the most pitiful government our city has ever had. I cannot describe to you how I feel, but I know many other people are right there with me, but they're not speaking.
Very good. Thank you, sir. Anyone else? You know, I'm going to make one comment here in regards to what we're doing. I think everyone up here feels like we're doing the right thing and we're doing what needs to be done. It's never easy setting up here, let me tell you. Been doing it for a long time, but at some point in time, you've got to do what you think's best for the people of the entire city. But you know, there's a little deja vu going on here, because a lot of what I'm hearing here, I've heard before, only the building wasn't Gabe's, it was the Executive Inn. You know, great things went on at the Executive Inn. It was a wonderful place. We should have made an effort to keep it, and we surely did, but eventually nobody wanted it, and we had to take it down. I honestly don't believe anything's going to happen to Gabe's Tire. It's not worth millions of dollars, Mr. Moreland. They only paid 200 and...
185, Mayor.
How much?
185.
$185,000, Mr. Moreland. They only paid $185,000 for it. Is that correct? I believe. Okay. It's not worth much.
John made one, did they?
Shh. He left town.
You made it?
No, we didn't make it. Sir, keep quiet, please, unless you're recognized. If you want to speak, you're more than welcome to come up there. But again, it's not a debate here. We've done this before, and we had to take the executive end down, and we're going to have to take Gabe's down. With that, did we vote on this? We haven't voted on this yet. Call for the vote.
Mayor Pro Tem Sanford?
Yes.
Commissioner Glenn?
Yes.
Commissioner Nunley?
Yes.
Mayor Payne?
Yes. Motion passes. Next item, Counselor.
Municipal Order 28-2016, a municipal order authorizing the mayor to execute an economic development incentive agreement with Alarica Incorporated, whereby the city shall incentivize the company with a payment of $250,000 per year for 6 years to offset the cost of locating in our community and creating jobs with an annual total wage of not less than $10,296,000. Introduced and publicly read for approval this fourth day of October 2016.
Have motion for approval.
Motion.
Second.
Second. Mr. Ray, you going to walk us through this?
I will. Mayor and commissioners, typically when there's an incentive plan for a business coming into Owensboro, there's a 10-year plan, incentive plan. This is a 6-year plan. The bottom line of what this comes from is that the city of Owensboro and the state of Kentucky was in head-to-head a competition with Tennessee, and it came down to the bottom line that they wanted to locate in Owensboro, Kentucky because of two things. One, what the city had done and what workforce we can provide, and two, the plans that the city has looked at in phase one of downtown and what they're doing out on 54, what they're doing out on the west side, everything that is planned to happen. They wanted to be in Owensboro, Kentucky. But it was just under $300,000 a year more expensive based on what they were getting in incentives from Tennessee than it was for being here in Kentucky. This $250,000 a year is part of what makes up that difference, that economic difference between the cost of doing business in Tennessee with the incentives the state was giving them and the cost doing here in Owensboro. And the county is also joining in the economic incentive package, which they're going to entertain that I think later on in their meeting. This is recruiting a target amount of 550 jobs, and they've already announced their goal is to have 830 jobs, so we fully expect them to exceed that. But the key, that's a target number. The key critical number here is the amount of actual wages paid to employees. That's how we have, over time, best been able to measure compliance with these types of agreements. So that amount is the $10,296,000 a year in wages paid to employees in Owensboro. If they meet that, which is a true measurable amount to our accounting department, then they're eligible for the $250,000. If they fall anywhere below that, they're not eligible that year, and the city would retain those amounts. But I go back to the one, the 6-year agreement versus a 10-year KBI agreement. And over the life of what we have downtown as far as our TIF, I remind that I believe our staff recommendation is that it's a small investment to make with a more than $4 billion economic impact over a period of 20 years. So we recommend that you would approve this incentive.
You know, and we talked about this earlier, and remind me again what that number was, economic impact of Alarica is on our community.
It's over $4 billion over 20 years.
$4 billion. That's a significant number. But I also, again, point out, and again, this was in the discussions about the budget amendment, but the money here, the $250,000, is coming out of that economic development fund, which was created to do this very thing, right. And that was to provide incentives to future economic development. So we've got that money. We're going to have that money. and it'll come out of this fund designed to do this very thing. So I want to make that point. But again, any questions, comments of Mr. Ray? Anybody at the public? If not, Ed, stay up there. I've got a question. It doesn't relate to this, but I forgot to ask it a while ago. Let's call for the vote.
Commissioner Glenn?
Yes.
Commissioner Nunley?
Yes.
Mayor Payne?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Sanford?
Yes.
Very good. Thank you. Motion passes. In regards to this Gates issue, you know, we're giving the staff authorization to proceed with this. What is the what's the next step here? When are we going to see this thing on this table again?
Well, the discussions with the current owners will continue, and one method for it to come back to the City Commission is if we reach a price that we would take back to you and say, this is a negotiated price, can we get your approval for that to move forward? Understanding also that there are a significant amount of debt on that facility already for unpaid contractors that have done the asbestos remediation. So all that needs to be taken into consideration. So if a negotiated price for the purchase of the property comes to fruition, we'll bring that back to you, commissioners. Yes, ma'am.
If not,
and if not, then what we would do is we plan to go ahead and file the petition for condemnation within the next 45 days. So what we would bring back to you is simply an update.
That's what I wanted to hear. You're saying 45 days. Yes, Commissioner.
And do we have indications that these gentlemen have been trying to sell this property during this period of time?
Yeah, I have not any firsthand information that they've been trying to sell it. I do know that they've continued to tell us the same course of action that they've been telling us since the initial construction or really demolition started. So at this point in time, 2 years ago, we didn't have really a method for moving transit. The 54 project hadn't been approved. The need for additional routes hadn't existed. And had the developers done what they said they were going to do, then we'd be looking for an alternate spot. However, given the triplet twist program and process, giving what we are going to need from a public transit ability, and given the fact of the absolute lack of attention to that building over that period of time, we've recommended that we move forward, and we appreciate that approval.
And I would just add to that, given the frustration and anger of a lot of the citizens in this community, that building continues to stand is another reason for me.
Very good. I just want to clarify that. Thank you, Mr. Ray. Mr. Parrish, we'll now go to the city manager's items.
Thank you, Mayor. I'm asking the commission to consider the following personnel appointments tonight. John Nance, probationary full-time, non-civil service appointment, labor maintenance helper, effective October 10th. Alice Berry, probationary full-time, non-civil service promotional appointment, bus driver, effective October 17th. Matthew Ward, regular full-time, non-civil service appointment, mechanic, effective October 1st. David Johnson, regular full-time, non-civil service appointment, construction inspector, effective October 12th. And Abby Shelton, regular full-time, non-civil service appointment as Community Development Director, effective October 19th.
Do we have a motion for approval?
Motion.
Second.
Any questions? Anybody? Call for the vote.
Commissioner Nunley?
Yes.
Mayor Payne?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Sanford?
Yes.
Commissioner Glenn?
Yes.
Very good. Motion passes. Anything else, Mr. Parrish?
Three other items, Mayor. First, the citizens should start to see these OMU inserts that OMU has allowed us to put in their monthly mail out. Those will indicate that leaf season will start October 18th. That means the week of 10 to 14 October will be the last time for brush and bush collection on your particular trash day. The second is, Mayor, you may have noticed that our city clerk is operating from an e-tablet, from a tablet. I'm monitoring an e-tablet, as is the assistant city clerk. So per your direction, we're moving towards e-meetings. And finally, Mayor, I'd just like to recognize EDC did a great job bringing the Alorica project to the city. But I have to say that Ed Ray has done all of the negotiations and work for this very complicated project. Nobody else in city government could have handled that other than Ed.
Anything else?
No, Mayor, that's all.
Well, I want to echo that too, because off and on I was involved with Mr. Ray and the things he was doing, and Ed, well done. I got to tell you, well done in putting all that together. I also want to commend Tim. There he is, Tim. Awesome air show. Great job. Well done to everybody. Everybody in your staff. Public safety, police, fire, all you guys, that went off very, very well, and that's an indication of good management and professionalism. So, Bill, thank you and everybody involved with that. Awesome show. I'll start over here. Let's start with the Mayor Pro Tem.
Yeah, I just wanted to make mention of Alorica, and you know, when you said $4 billion, that really caught my attention. Then I did a little quick math on specialty food groups, and I believe, if my math is correct, that would be another $28,454,400 per year on top of that in economic impact. So you look at what's going on in this community, the growth is tremendous. And we're just getting started, and I'm seeing more and more investment coming in here, and these numbers are tremendous, and I appreciate everything you've done, Ed, and the rest of the commission has done a wonderful job. I appreciate working with you guys, and I think the city's on a roll. So that's all I have.
Commissioner Nunley.
Well, my term will soon be over, but one of the things that I've been so impressed with the way things have developed, the way we've progressed so beautifully, is that people work so well together. And this is a prime example, the Alorica. You had your private investors, Jack Wells and Matt Hayden, Madison with EDC, Ed, Bill, the mayor, the commission, all working for the betterment of this community. And these people saw that we wanted them. They saw what we had done before with this community in working so well together. So that's the important thing, is that we've all got to roll up our sleeves and work well together and make tough, important decisions. And that's how things change. That's how things get better.
Commissioner.
Yes, I want to also thank Ed Ray and our for his great work on Alorica, and also our city staff, including Parks, for all their great work this weekend with the air show. I can't emphasize enough, it was a wonderful event for the city. If the weather had cooperated a little bit, we might have had a little bigger crowds, but we still had over 25,000 people, and that's not to be sneezed at. That's a lot of people. One of the other things I just want to address briefly is the Tower Inn. I've actually physically been in there. When this company from Levittown, Pennsylvania first came and offered us, you know, a Hail Mary that maybe they could do something in regard to upgrading and revitalizing the Tower Inn, I went in there, and I mean, it already was in bad repair, and then they had the asbestos issue and a number of other items. And the biggest issue we've got is, as far as that's concerned, because I drive by it every day, is public safety. And you might say, well, what are you going to replace it with? I can't emphasize enough. I have young people, working people who take the bus every day. And moving that bus and transit station to that location will help them. As our city manager Parrish has indicated, it will shorten the route times. And I can assure you, if you're a student or a working person trying to get someplace, you want to be able to get there as quickly as possible, just like someone driving a car, and you want to get there safely. And I believe that this is a huge plus for the community in the long term. More importantly, Alorica coming to this community is a home run for this city. It's going to provide jobs for hundreds of people, not just in Owensboro, but throughout our region. And I believe there'll be a ripple effect, because as Mayor Pro Tem has pointed out, the positive momentum this community is experiencing is unprecedented in the time I've been here, and I think we're going to continue to see more positive announcements in the coming year as people begin to recognize, as they already are, Owensboro is a great place to live and a great place to work and a great place to raise a family.
Very good. Anyone from the public? Comments? If not, entertain a motion. We adjourn.
So moved.
Second.
Call for the vote.
Mayor Payne?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Sanford?
Yes.
Commissioner Glenn?
Yes.
Commissioner Nunley?
Yes.
We are adjourned. Thank everybody for coming.